about the combinatorial theory of continued fraction. So this lecture, chapter 3a, is dedicated to my good friend Philippe Flageolet. Very nice man, and he died a few years ago. So he has a very important role in France for between computer science and combinatorics, and he loved so much continued fraction. And he gave this seminal lemma in 1980 on continued fraction to start the combinatorial theory of a general orthogonal polynomial. So he has the three inspiration in continued fraction by Euler, Ramanujan, and Donald Knuth, because he was the mixing between analysis of algorithm and pure mathematics, especially continued fraction. And this was one of these last Happy New Year 10 years ago. And if you read, it may be difficult to read. There is a very complicated, it's a summation over the, on the lattice, a square lattice, and there is a very complicated continued fraction. So that was in the last time of his life. He was again very interested in continued fraction. So he was between math and computer science. He organized his field in France very well. There was many students, many people, many groups at the limit between discrete math, computer science, analysis of algorithm, formal calculus, probability, and combinatorics, etc. And he had created a group called ALEA. ALEA is for aléatoire. In French, aléatoire means random. So it's a mixture of people from probability, from combinatorics, from analysis of algorithm, from asymptotic combinatorics. And then his student and create every year there is a famous seminaire Flageolet at the Institut Henri Poincaré, where there is a famous Bourbaki seminaire. So it's four times a year, then it's a full day. It's three talks in a day, and this is becoming a famous seminar in France. It's on the web also. You have the summary of the seminar. And he has written about 16 papers on the combinatorics of continued fraction. So you can find in the reference of this on my website for this part four, I have written a survey of these 16 papers. Because we are supposed to publish the collected papers of Flageolet. It's, I think, six volumes of it was supposed to be published by Cambridge University Press, but I don't know what happened. So this is a nice survey of his 16 papers on continued fraction. Oh, he has invented also the term analytic combinatorics. And he has written a big book. It took maybe 10 years with Robert Sedgwick, a colleague in the United States. And here the book just appeared. This is, they get the Leroy Steele Prize this year for the popularization of mathematics. And here you see this picture was taken in Paris for his 60th birthday in 2008. And the book just come appear for his 60th birthday. So he was very happy to show the book. And you can hear, I love analytic combinatorics. See, different quantities. Means enumerative, algebraic, and bijective combinatorics. Philippe was analytic combinatorics, this word of, he coined the word, and now everybody. So it's a very nice book. At the beginning, there is also starting with enumerative combinatorics and what I have done in part one about symbolic method for connection between genetic function and operation on object. So today we will work on start with continued fraction, and this slide is one of us. Last slide of one of his talk. At the end of the talk, you see it's connected to special function, number theory, summability, analysis, orthogonal polynomial, combinatorics, probability, and that's all, folk. that was one of his slides at the end of the talk. He liked to give on the analytic combinatorial continued fraction. So we'll start with a classical arithmetic or number theory continued fraction. We start at the very beginning level, like the golden number. Golden number can be expanded in continued fraction. This is a well-known number theory contraction, 1 over 1 plus 1 over 1 plus 1, etc., etc. And at the limit, if you go to the limit of this infinite fraction, you get the golden number minus 1. So in contraction, you can cut. If you cut at a certain level, you get what is called convergence of the conic fraction. So if you cut at a level, two level, you get 2 over 3. If you cut the next level, you get 3 over 5. And more generally, if you cut after k level like this, you get fk over fk plus 1. So you get the ratio of two Fibonacci numbers. This is well known. I will give a special lecture on the Ramanujan continuum fraction. I gave it in the Ramanujan Institute, in Divers Institute, but maybe we can record it and add it to the course here. And I will give you a combinatorial proof that the limit of this ratio is a golden number. It's possible using Ramanujan continuum fraction. So see, this ratio is usually also there is some interpretation in nature. The ratio of two contiguous Fibonacci numbers is the number of spiral in some flower, everything, etc. So the golden number is hidden everywhere, and it's hidden in this continuous fraction. So this is a simple number theory fraction, but there is much more advanced continuous fraction. You know, there was the famous proof of Apéry that the zeta of 3 for the Riemann zeta function is irrational number. And to prove this, zeta of 3 is irrational, he used this continuous fraction. You see power 6, 6, 3 power 8, etc. And omega here is this. And we'll see at the end of this talk that Flageolet was also relating this continuous fraction to some combinatorial and analytic continuous fraction. We'll see it will reappear at the end of this talk. So this was in number theory. But no, analytic continuous fraction means there is a variable. You are expanding a power theory or a function like tangenti, secanti, etc. You are expanding into continuous fraction. So this is called analytic continuous fraction. It started at the time of Euler. Even before Euler also, there is some. So he has two important big chapters on the continuous fraction, on the expansion of in analysis like this one. I already showed this before, maybe. It's so you see, there is a variable x. Here there is a 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. And you get an expansion into infinite analytic continuous fraction of this power series, of this formal power series, which the coefficient of x power n is a number of involution with no fixed point. We have seen this in relation with Hermit polynomial. And Euler also has an expansion of the generating function, formal generating function for permutation and factorial. He expanded it into this kind of continuous fraction. So the coefficient you see in terms of x is 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6, 6, etc. So he has many such expansion. This is called Stieltjes continuous fraction. It will be called later Stieltjes continuous fraction. So this continuous fraction is not the one related we have seen with this, with Jacobi, with Laguerre-Historé and Biquet-Lambdeke. This is not given by Laguerre-Historé. It's given by some other combinatorics. Even I found in Euler this beautiful continuous fraction. So the same as for permutation, for n factorial. But then you have you see this every two levels there is a parameter. And if you look here, this parameter, m plus n, this is the Stirling number. It's counting permutation by number of cycles, or number of left to right minimum element. This polynomial here, this coefficient. So we will explain this next time. I will explain this Euler continuous fraction by showing that this enumerating permutation by number of left to right minimum element. And this is the Stirling number, the moment of Laguerre polynomial, alpha, alpha plus 1, alpha plus 2, alpha plus 3, alpha plus 4, in other notation. But so yes, some a lot. This was the starting point. And then further later, we have seen in the introduction, chapter 0, that this was the starting point for orthogonal polynomial. And then analysis, they forget the starting point quantum fraction, and they go mainly on orthogonal polynomial. But because quantum fraction with flageolet are coming back in combinatorics, so now we need, there is a combinatorial, so quantum fraction come back again in combinatorics, in parallel with the combinatorics of orthogonal polynomial. So of course, there is many quantum fraction in Ramanujan work, like this one, this beautiful quantum fraction, and equal to this beautiful product. And this, he sent this to a letter to Hardy. That was the first letter to Hardy, and when there was many formula like this. And Hardy, when he sees this, he says, "This formula defeated me completely. I have never seen anything in the list like this before. A single look at them is enough to show they could only be written down by a mathematician of the highest class. They must be true, because no one would have the imagination to invent them." So you send this to a professor in England, and then you get an invitation to go to Cambridge with such formula. So here is Ramanujan and Hardy, and then they work together for, oh, everybody knows the story. Maybe they make 30 papers together, Ramanujan and this formula I show you come from the famous Ramanujan quantum fraction. It's a Q fraction, 1, Q, Q2, Q3, Q4. So this comes from this quantum fraction, and this quantum fraction, in fact, is equal to the ratio of the two left-hand side of the famous Roger Ramanujan identities. See, here is the two Roger Ramanujan identities. The sum of this equals this infinite product. Sum of this is just, there is just a difference, a shift by n, equals this infinite product. All the number I equal 2 and 3 modulo 5. Here is 1 and 4 modulo 5. The 1 and 4 modulo 5, yeah, 2 and 3 modulo 5. So if you take the ratio of these two infinite products, you get the Ramanujan continued fraction. Or equivalently, if you take the ratio of the left-hand side, you get the Ramanujan quantum fraction. So maybe I plan to give a special lecture on Ramanujan quantum fraction and prove this by pure easy bijection to prove this identity. Infinite product, it's much more difficult. I don't claim to work with infinite product, but working with this, the ratio of the two left-hand side give you in a simple way this. There's a nice proof with using heaps of diamonds. So I claim that this class is supposed to be independent of the other class, to be followed by students who are starting in combinatorics. So maybe everybody knows this, but I will just remind you the basic fact in part one, chapter 1a, about formal power theory and operation on colloidal object and the relation between the formal power theory, the operation and the algebra of formal power theory, and the operation on the object. So go back to chapter 1, chapter 1a, part 1, chapter 1a. So I will go fast because I think everybody knows more or less all this. So formal power theory, it's in one variable with its ring on coefficient can be z, q, c, or the ring coefficient even can be with parameter alpha, beta, etc. So you have a polynomial, the polynomial algebra, in one variable on the ring K, and then the formal power theory, it's like infinite polynomial plus point, point, point. And you extend the operation of the algebra of a polynomial into formal power theory. You can define the sum of two power series, a product, and product by scalar, and this make an algebra of the formal power theory. So there is an operation I will need in today. I will need especially the inverse of a power theory. If the coefficient constant term is zero, the order of the power theory is the degree, minimum degree of the non-zero coefficient. So if the order is at least or greater or equal to one, then you have the inverse of the power theory. I will use this. I will not use the derivative. And in combinatorics, so this is the main tool that the generating function of some numbers. If you have a sequence of number in combinatorics, then the generating function or your polynomial, any sequence an, it can be polynomial in parameter alpha beta, then you get the generating function. And also there is another exponential generating function, the exponential generating function. So today, only ordinary generating function. You have seen in Euler quantum fraction, The derivative function of n factorial was ordinary derivative function. In chapter 5, then I will use exponential derivative function to give interpretation of the coefficient of orthogonal polynomial. And then I will also remind you some elementary facts on the relationship between operation on exponential derivative function and operation on the quaternary object, to take the product, to take the exponential, etc. And there is a notion of family. You have an infinite here number of polynomial, and you can, this makes sense, the sum of all this, or you can make the sum of fi, or in the notation, I take the sigma of a n t power n, so it's infinite. So you have a definition of a family of a power series summable, like this one. It's summable because if you look only all the term, all the contribution to a certain term, fixed term, T4, T5, T6, then there is only a finite number of this infinite family of polynomial. Only a finite number contributes to the coefficient. So see the detail in the part one. This is a very simple example of a summable family, and you get the Fibonacci number here, which means that 1 over 1 minus t plus t2 is the derivative function of Fibonacci numbers. So there is some operation on formal power theory. Now I am going to remind you operation, the analog to lift this operation at the level of commutative object. So this is again chapter 1a. So this is typically, you can read in the first section of the book of Flageolet and Sedgwick on analytic quadratics, there is this what he like to call the symbolic method. So you can define in an abstract way what is a quaternary object. It's some set, it's a finite or enumerable set, and each element of this, each quaternary object has a weight, a valuation. But there is some axiomatic, and I'm not going to repeat it. Go back to the slide of part one. The axiomatic is to make this to make sense. You have the generating function of this weighted quaternary object will be the sum of all the weight of all quaternary objects. And I suppose that this family of power series is summable, that it makes sense in the formal way of summation of a of generating function. So this is in an abstract way, the quaternary object. There's a family of A plus a valuation. A typical example, very simple example, is you take a variable t and the weight v of alpha is t power n. And you can call this the size, abstract size, even if there is no size. So if the weight is t power n, then you can define this, a generating function, as soon as there is a finite number of objects, such that the weight is given t power n for a fixed n. As soon as you have this condition, then this makes sense to make the generating function. So we have defined in part one, 3 years ago, the sum of two quaternary objects. There is some weight. So the sum is a union with a disjoint. This reflects the summation of power series. We have defined also the product of two family of weighted quaternary objects. The product is like the Cartesian product, and then the weight on the product must be the product of the weight. And so you have this fundamental lemma that this reflects the product of generating function. A typical example is binary tree. In modern combinatorics, you'd say binary tree at the level of quaternary object. I am working here with complete binary tree is else a point, or else is a triple roots, left binary tree and right binary tree. If you work with complete binary, if you work with ordinary binary tree, then you can just put empty binary tree plus. And so once you have this equation, this is an equation on this level of quaternary object, on the set of binary tree of roots, this is the sum of two family of quaternary objects, this is the product. And then you project this at the analytic level. You are at the garden of quaternary object, which is makes me much more space at the analytic level. It's at like the floor level. So if you project it at the analytic level, you get this equation for the generative function of binary tree, which is well known quadratic algebraic equation. Oh, we have the same. We are working with Motkin pass, Dick pass many times here. So let's just do this for Dick pass. So a Dick pass, for example, you look the first time you are reaching back zero level, then you can decompose in a unique way. Here you have a north-east step, then you have again a dig path shifted by your own level and another dig path. So you get immediately this algebraic equation. Because the dig path is a product of this by this by this by this at the level of frontal object. So you have the same equation for dig path and binary tree. And if you reflect these two equations, then you get the bijection, classical bijection between binary tree and this. So maybe another example, because we are using a lot of Motkin paths. So you have the analog for Motkin paths. Motkin paths, you have this algebraic equation for Motkin paths. This is a generating function for Motkin paths. You look the first time you reach the x-axis, and maybe to the Motkin path can be Nante, or maybe it can start. The first time you reach the x-axis, it can be starting with the east step. So the Motkin path can start with an east step, and then what follows is a Motkin path. Or if it starts with a north-east step, like this one, then you look the first time you go back to x-axis, and you get the analog like for dig path. You get this T2 and 2. So this is a very classical equation for Motkin path. For the flageolet, main Lehmann Cauchy fraction, we'll have another decomposition of Motkin path. Instead of this algebraic equation, we will look in a different way, and this will start the recursion for continued fraction. So I will need also the notion of seconds. If you have a certain object A, seconds of object is ante plus the object itself, plus a pair of two, plus a three, plus etc., and tuple over. So it takes a disjoint sum of all this, and the generative function for seconds of object in ordinary function is 1 over 1 minus the generative function of the objects themselves. I will give an example with the classical notion of partition, of n, to show that this relation 1 over 1 minus between this relation is the generative function of object and generative function for seconds of object, which is defined by this equation. So everybody know what is a partition of n. You decompose n into a certain partition, and you, for example, 43, and you make a visualization of this partition with a Ferrer diagram, or in physics it's a Young diagram where you make like this. So the number of cells in each row is exactly the number of parts of this partition. Parts go weakly decreasing. We don't consider an order between the parts. It's just so you can always consider it decreasing and weakly decreasing, and the sum is 43. So what is a generating function? Euler also was working a lot on the generating function for partition. He had beautiful formula for partition. He was competing in England with MacMahon, and he has very beautiful formula. And now this formula can be applied for physics, quantum physics of black hole. So this is very few years ago. Some formula of Euler appear in the if you use string theory for the quantum physics of black hole, then some formula can be proved using this generating function for partition, but at the power 24. You see, if you suppose you are in dimension 24 in string theory, and well, this is another story, but let's go back to our partition. So the generating function for integer partition is the following. So if you have only partition with a Ferrer diagram with one row, so it's a single monomial q power i. If there is i point, it's only q power i. So now if you take a sequence of such i, which make a rectangle, with i column, it's just a sequence of row. So if you know the generative function for one row, you get the generative function for sequence of row, which is a generative function for rectangle. Ferrer diagram is a rectangle with i column. Now, if you take a general Ferrer diagram, so any Ferrer diagram can be decomposed as a product in the sense of product of object of rectangle. So here is a rectangle with three columns, rectangle with five columns, rectangle with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. But there is some, see, this is at the time of overhead projector, when there was no video projector. So some slides are empty. I mean, there is no rectangle with four columns. I see. When I put 1 over 1 minus qi, it starts with 1 plus qi plus q2i. So 1 is the empty rectangle. And so you get, applying the theorem of product of object, you get this product as soon as this rectangle as is bounded by m, number of columns is bounded by m. And then easily you go to the limit. If there is no bound on the number of columns of each rectangle, you get this infinite product, which is a well-known generating function for partition given by Ramanujan and Euler. And, so let's go back now with this preliminary, just to warm the new souvenir of part one. Let's go to the analytic continued fraction general theory. So this was started by Euler and Gauss, etc., but then Stieltjes at the end of the 19th century. Stieltjes, Jacobi, 1850, 1860, 1870, they defined. So we are going to work with two kinds of continued fraction. This was a kind of Ramanujan and Euler continued fraction. For Ramanujan, lambda k was minus q power k. For Euler, lambda 1 was 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, etc. So you have a second lambda k of coefficient in the ring k, and you get this infinite fraction. I will call this S for Stieltjes, T, and lambda. Lambda is the second of lambda k. And then the second kind was by Jacobi. So you have two seconds, bk lambda k. Bk start at 0, and lambda k start at k bigger or equal to 1. And then you have this kind of fraction, 1 minus b0 t minus lambda 1 t2 divided by 1 minus b1 t minus lambda 2, etc., etc. So this will be the Stieltjes and Jacobi, two kind of, and in general, any formal power theory, any function can be, in general, can be expanded into Jacobi continued fraction and also into Stieltjes continued fraction. And next chapter, chapter 4, we'll see some algorithm, 3 or 4 algorithm to compute the bk lambda k once you know the generating function, because the bk lambda k or the lambda k are unique. So the classical theory, I have reminded you this in chapter 0. So there is two different theories. There is a continued fraction theory, with especially a J fraction, because Stieltjes is a special case with the bk equals 0. So you have the Jacobi continued fraction. Any formal power theory in general can be expanded like this. Then there is a theory of orthogonal polynomial, where again there is also some bk lambda k coefficient satisfying the three-term linear recurrence relation. And there is a strong relation between the two theories. So at the beginning, orthogonal polynomial was starting from the continued fraction. And then after an analysis, after in the 1930, I have reduced the introduction of Zego book in 1930. It's a very classical book. And they say now continued fraction disappeared of the theory and only orthogonal polynomial are considered. But now with the combinatorics, continued fraction appear again. It's a So the classical theory, what is the relation between these two theories? Because in both sides, there is a bk lambda k. So the relation is that orthogonal polynomial, they have some moments. They have orthogonality is defined by a linear functional. Linear functional is defined by the action of f on a monomial tn, and this is called the mu n. And then the generative function of the moments are exactly the expansion of this continued fraction. So the moment here becomes the generating function of the moment on this side. See where f of xn equals to mu n. There is a second relation. If you cut your continued fraction, we have seen for the golden number, if you cut, you get the Fibonacci number. So you can do exactly define the convergence of a continued fraction. It's going to be a rational generating function, which give in a certain way an approximation of your infinite continued fraction. You get a rational an approximation by the rational fraction of this generating function. And so the convergents are going to be, there is a numerator and a denominator. And then this is a reciprocal. here, star means reciprocal of the orthogonal polynomial which are here. So you can get the orthogonal polynomial reciprocal. This is, we will see what it means. Delta, it's a shift in the valuation BK lambda K. So you can get in numerator and numerator some orthogonal polynomial as the convergent of the quantum fraction. So now I will start with the fundamental flageolet lemma. So the fundamental, I call this lemma with a capital L. I will explain why. So it gives a commutative interpretation of a Jacobi quantum fraction in terms of weighted path. So this is a seminal paper in 1980 where he introduced the combinatorial aspect of quantum fraction. And some famous commentarists say that this theorem was much trivial on a shallow theorem. He explained, Flageolet explained this in a paper he has written on the seminar Lotharian in 2006. So I propose to lift this theorem, where there was some polemic on this theorem, it was too trivial, to give him the status of a lemma with a capital L. So you can see the essence of mathematics is proving theorem. And so that is what mathematicians do, they prove theorem. But to tell the truth, what they really want to prove once in their lifetime is a lemma with a capital L. Like the one, for example, by Fatou in analysis, or the lemma of Gauss in number theory, or Bernstein lemma in combinatorics. And now what makes a mathematical statement a true lemma? First, it should be applicable to a wide variety of instances, even seemingly unrelated problems. Secondly, the statement should, once you have seen it, be completely obvious. And the reaction of the reader might be of joint envy. Why I have not noticed this before? And thirdly, it must be an aesthetic level. The lemma, including the proof, should be beautiful. So I think I can state, like the LGV lemma, where it's very easy to prove, but nobody has before, when you will see this lemma, it's beautiful, the proof is short, beautiful, and then it can apply to many, many different situations. So I call this flageolet lemma because once you know the combinatorics, there is plenty of quantum fraction which can be explained. Like we have explained the moment of the five Schaeffer polynomial. So many, many quantum fraction with a simple lemma that quantum fraction is weighted Motkin path. Then if you put history on the path, history on the weight, then you can explain hundreds of quantum fraction by using this lemma. So here a Jacobi quantum fraction and the weight Motkin path, so we have already seen weighted Motkin path with the weight BK lambda K. BK, you have two sequences, BK lambda K, and BK when you are at level K, you put a BK for ordinal step, you put a lambda K when you go down, and you put a 1 when you go up. And then the flageolet lemma is that the sum of the weight of all these Motzkin paths give you a combinatorial interpretation of the Jacobi quantum fraction. Jacobi quantum fraction is nothing but a weighted Motzkin path by the BK lambda K. So it was more or less implicit in some physics paper with a three-diagonal matrix, everything. But it was not explicitly stated that Jacobi quantum fraction can be interpreted as weighted Motkin path. The same way as we have done for orthogonal polynomial. Proof. So take a Motkin path, a weighted Motkin path, like this. But now do not do like we have done before, like the quadratic equation, algebraic equation, to see the first time you are reaching the zero level. But then you cut the Motkin path like this. So any Motkin path is in bijection with a sequence of primitive Motkin path. Primitive Motkin path means you cannot decompose this path into a product of two other Motkin paths. So primitive Motkin path, it means there is two kinds of primitive Motkin paths. Else, it's a level each step at the zero level. Or else, you go up at the north step, and then you go down, and you touch the x-axis only twice, like for this step. primitive Hodgkin paths, the starting point and ending point are the only point on the horizontal axis. And every Hodgkin path can be decomposed in a unique sequence of such primitive Hodgkin paths. So we can write by applying the lemma, if you know the geretic function of a component, which is primitive Hodgkin path, then you know the geretic function of a sequence of primitive Hodgkin paths. So we get, and I put the weight of bk lambda k, the sum of the weight of all Hodgkin paths, t power the length of the Hodgkin path, is 1 over 1 minus the same sum for primitive Hodgkin paths. Okay, so now primitive Hodgkin paths with the weight. Where is the t? Yes, there should be a t here. Okay. Here, if I put a t here, yeah, it should be a t. Yeah, yes. Sorry, there should be a t here. So primitive Hodgkin path with the weight now, if you put the weight, so if this kind of weight, you have B0T. If it's a primitive Hodgkin path with a northeast and southeast step at the end, so this step will be weighted lambda 1T. Okay, and now look, you can decompose this kind of primitive Hodgkin path into a northeast step, which with the weight T. Then again, a Hodgkin path, this is a general Hodgkin path, shifted by one level, multiplied by lambda 1t. So I can write that there is two kinds of primitive Hodgkin path, B0t minus lambda 1t2, and the same, it's going to be the sum of the weight of all such primitive Hodgkin paths, but shifted by one level. You shift one level, so the weight, if you consider this to be the zero level now, you have to shift. So this is the operator delta, shifting the weight. You replace bk by bk plus 1 and lambda k by lambda k plus 1. So this will be the sum of the shifted weight of the same Hodgkin path. So this is the explanation of the shift. And so I can repeat the operation. That now I can repeat it, and 1 over, so this is shifted Hodgkin path at level 1, and here is the sum of the weight of all Hodgkin paths shifted by 2. So you repeat it, and you get your Jacobi Cugnot fraction. So you're just applying Hodgkin path, the product of primitive Hodgkin paths. Primitive Hodgkin paths, there's two kinds of primitive, this one or this one, and if you delete for this kind of the northeast southeast step lambda 1, then you get again a general Hodgkin path where every weight has been shifted by 1. Meaning bk becomes bk plus 1, lambda k becomes lambda k plus 1. Or even Flageolet was in RIA, in theoretical computer science, so in theoretical computer science we like word, automata. So even you can write this decomposition. You can write it, if you like, free monoids, word, etc., in non-commutative variable. This decomposition I have done in commutative with 1 over 1 minus sequence, etc., etc. You can rewrite this completely. The star operation is 1 over 1 minus something. It's analog, but in non-commutative variable. So if you like free monoid, all this, if you're in the background of theoretical computer science, you have the analog even in non-commutative variable. Don't know if it has been useful. Okay, so now let's go to the relation between Cauchy fraction and orthogonal polynomial. So we have seen the classical theory, all this relation. There is two relations. Here the geretic function of moment appear, here the moment. And the convergent appear, the polynomial appear as a reciprocal. So we have seen that J fraction by the Flageolet lemma is interpreted by sum of weighted Hodgkin paths. Now if you go back to chapter 1, the consequence of the main theorem, F of PKPL equal x power n, give you the orthogonality, the Favart theorem, orthogonality of the, that if you put this weight, the same weight on the Hodgkin path, then the moments are the sum of the weight. So the main theorem in chapter 1, I have proved that if you have an orthogonal polynomial for a certain sequence of moments, then the moments are exactly the sum of the weight of what's in pass. So combining the two propositions, you get this equivalence. Now the equivalence with convergent, we will see in another section of this lecture how to prove that the convergent are really the reciprocal of an orthogonal polynomial. So some example, we have seen n factorial in Euler two function. So the Laguerre polynomial, the general Laguerre is theory were defined by bk equal to k plus 2, lambda k, k, k plus 1, mu n equal n plus 1. But in fact, it was better to work with restricted Laguerre history. Restricted Laguerre history give you the moment n factorial, give you this restricted value. 2k plus 1, 2 is replaced by 2k plus 1. Lambda k is replaced by k to the square. And then you get this Jacobi Cantor fraction for n factorial. So this we have given a proof by using restricted Laguerre history. We have shown that the sum of the weight of all Motkin paths with this weight gives you n factorial. So all the proof we have done for orthogonal polynomial, for Scheffer, orthogonal, etc., all these proofs give you at the same time not only the proof of the moments, but the proof of the expansion into continued fraction. But Euler, you see, Euler, he gave an expansion of continued fraction, but it is still yes, continued fraction. It's not the same as Jacobi. Jacobi, you see, the, for n factorial, you have all this 1, 3, 5, and yes, you have to put a minus, because the sign is here, the sign is here in this. But if you take off the sign here, you have to put minus, minus, minus everywhere. It's better. But you see the coefficient now is it's a Stieltjes continued fraction with lambda k is 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4. So this is a Euler continued fraction. And the lambda k, you see now the lambda k, bk equals 0. And the lambda k is a ceiling of k over 2. You take k over 2 and the smallest integer bigger than k over 2. So this is lambda 1. Lambda 2 equal, for example, lambda 3, you divide 3 by 2, this is 1.5, 1.5, and so the ceiling is 2. So 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, and next time, in chapter 3b, I will prove this by using another bijection, another, between permutation and what we call subdivided Laguerre history. So you have two different continued fractions, Jacobi and Stieltjes. And for n factorial, you have two different explanations, Laguerre, restricted Laguerre history and subdivided Laguerre history. So we will do this, the relationship between these two histories and the relationship between the two kinds of Jacobi and Stieltjes continued fraction. So we will, there is an algorithm well known in the classical theory of continued fraction. If you take a Stieltjes continued fraction, then you can contract it and get a Jacobi continued fraction. So there is classical formula, but here we will prove this formula using the combinatorics of paths. Usually it's proved just by calculus. You glue the level 2 by 2, and then you see what happened of the knowing the lambda k of the Stieltjes, what is the bk lambda k of Jacobi. But here we'll do this bijectively. And also the history related, the Laguerre history and subdivided Laguerre history, we will also do this contraction inside the history, which will be related to the Laguerre heaps of segments. So convergent. Yes? Yes, it's the same. Yes, yes. If bk, yes, of course, it's. If you put bk equals 0, then you will get the Stieltjes continued fraction with a t to the square, because the length is 2n. But then you replace t2 by t, and then you get the Stieltjes continued fraction. It's a special case, bk equals 0, and everywhere there will be t2, so but the length of the dig pass is even, so you will put n for half of the length. So let's prove now the relationship between the convergent of the continued fraction and the orthogonal polynomial. So the convergent means I am going to cut, I am going to stop here at the bkt. You cut here. And if now you look the interpretation with paths, it's trivial that the Dirichlet function for the convergent is exactly the Dirichlet function weighted Jacobi, weighted Motkin pass, which are bounded by level K. You can reach a level, so you will have a coefficient BK, you will have a lambda K, but not a lambda K plus one here, it's forbidden. So all the indices BK lambda K must be less or equal to K. So if you cut here, you get exactly generating function of weighted Motkin path bounded by the level K. And so proposition, so this is trivial proposition. Want to know the interpretation. Interpretation that convergent is bounded Dieck path. And the proposition, I'm going to prove that the convergent, the generating function for weighted Motkin path bounded by height K, I have to show that it is a rational fraction like this. Where PK so there is an orthogonal polynomial related to the BK lambda K. And reciprocal means for a polynomial of degree K, you change T 1 over T and you multiply by T power K to get a polynomial. And what means delta? Delta, we have seen delta is a shift of the relation. So if I suppose I have some polynomial, a sequence of orthogonal polynomial defined by the three-term recurrence relation, and then the shift, the delta of Pn, this is a new sequence of orthogonal polynomial with a new valuation for the Favart theorem, but delta of BK is BK plus 1, delta of lambda K is lambda K plus 1. So I have different proofs of this formula. This will be a good way to revision of part 1. So there's Bajti proof, linear algebra proof, there is different proof. So easy proof, for example, the linear algebra proof, that go to part 1, chapter 1b, slides 79 to 91. And if you take a path, if you take a matrix, if you take path in a graph, where when you go from the vertex I to vertex j, there is a certain weight, A index ij, there is a certain matrix, which is a formal weight. And then the generating function of path going from I to j is the inverse of this matrix, and it's a cofactor divided by the determinant. And we are in this case for the convergent of the continuous fraction. We have some weighted parts on the graph. There is a matrix A, where it's a weight going from the vertex I to vertex J, because I am taking the sum of the weight bounded Motkin path. So which means I am taking paths on this graph, the segment 0 until K. Well, sorry, it's not the same K. But I take a bounded segment here. And the Motkin path is just an expansion in time of a path on this graph, finite graph, when you start from zero and you go up and down. At any step, you can stay at the same level. This will make a weight BK, or you can go up, or you can go down. And at the end, you might go back to the zero level. So we are exactly in to find a generative function for a weighted path. The weight is 1 when you go up, lambda k when you go down from level k, and bk when you're at level k. So I have to take the generating function of such weighted path on a finite graph, having k plus 1 element going from 0 to level k. And the matrix A of the linear algebra is exactly, we have seen, this is a three-diagonal matrix. We have expressed the orthogonal polynomial, linear orthogonal, as a determinant, the characteristic polynomial of the three-diagonal matrix. But where we are in the reciprocal polynomial. See, when you work with orthogonal polynomial, you will have 2 by 2 disjoint parage, cycle valence 1 or cycle valence 2, and you will put an x for each isolated point. Now it's different. The reciprocal, I will put a t for each of this point and a t to the square for each of these diameters. And we have seen that the classical definition of determinant when you have permutation and inversion, if you replace the matrix A by 1 minus A, then the determinant is the sum of all, we have already seen this in this section, part 4, in part 1 also, that this determinant is the sum of all minus 1 power R of 2 by 2 disjoint cycle on the graph, edges of the graph, and the weight, the product of the weight of the cycle, the product of the weight of each edges, and the proposition is that Generating function on a graph going from I of the path going from I to J is a numerator, the cofactor, and a determinant. The determinant is a generating function for all such 2x2 disjoint cycles. The numerator is sum of weight of all such configuration. So first, in blue, you choose a self-avoiding path going from I to J. And then you choose some cycle 2x2 disjoint and disjoint from this self-avoiding path. So this is a linear algebra proof, path in a graph where you have the determinant and cofactor, which are interpreted like this. It's an easy linear algebra lemma. And if I apply this proposition to my path here, see, starting from zero, I am bounded at level k, and I go up and down. So what is the denominator? It's configuration of 2x2 disjoint cycle, which is going to be exactly. So here the cycle, what are the cycles when you go such path? It's only cycle of length 1, which is weighted by bk, if I am at level k, and the cycle of length 2, when I go up and I go down, which is a dimer. This is a pavage. So it's configuration of 2x2 disjoint cycle. It's the red dimer, the blue dimer. It's exactly the reciprocal of pk plus 1. Pk plus 1 because I am on a segment of length k plus 1 from 0 to k, and reciprocal because the variable t is t for a cycle length 1 and t2 for a cycle length 2. And now, what is the denominator? The numerator must be the, if you interpret this picture, it's a self-avoiding walk going from I to J. So here, I equals J equals 0. So what you have is the self-avoiding walk is reduced to a point. You have a path, self-avoiding, going from 0 to 0. And then what remains is configuration of 2x2 disjoint cycle, which are disjoint from the path. So it must be exactly 2x2 pavage of the segment, a pavage which avoids the point 0. So pavage avoiding 0 is exactly isomorphic to this polynomial. You are taking pavage on the segment 1k. So it's exactly pk reciprocal with a shift delta. So it's just an application of this linear algebra proof. If you prefer bijective proof without using linear algebra, because this proposition of linear algebra, we get a proof in part one, bijective proof also. So I can also get a bijective proof direct and compare with the bijective proof we get in part one 3 years ago. So a bijective proof of convergent. This is the sum of the weight of all the paths, Motkin paths bounded by k. So it's maybe this divided by this. So I multiply the denominator. I have to prove all this is equal to reduced to this. So I have to prove on the left, you have a pavage of this segment 0k. The reciprocal means that you put a t or t2 on the pieces, and then you have a Motkin path. And there is a sign reversing in involution. If you look back the sign reversing involution we have done for the main theorem, it's exactly the same. I am going to try to take one of these pieces here, put it in the path. Or take a piece here in the path, put it here. So what you are doing, you see, you look the path. And if you go back to this proof we have done in part 4, chapter 1c, we are looking the path. The first time there was a dimer, the first time there was something here, and we are trying to move one of these pieces to the path. So we do exactly the same. You take the path, you go up, 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 up. Then the first time you make a cycle, it can be going down, you make a cycle in two, or it can be making a point. So you are first time you do this, and then you take your pavage on the left, and then you take the first time you meet the pieces. You compare the two here, and you exchange. And this is involution. So everybody is killed, except a few couple are not killed. Which couple are not killed in this involution? See, it's the same involution as before in chapter 1 of this course, part 4, but with different conditions. I am proving something different, so this will not work. So everybody will be killed, except, so the path will always be empty. If the path is not empty, you can always do the involution. So the past can be empty, but the condition is that if the past is empty, if you are going to take a piece here and put it in the past, the piece, see, if it does not contain the 0 point, it will not work. If you take any pieces of which does not contain the point zero, then we will not, you will not be able to put in the path, because you are at a level too high. So the first piece, you see, the pair will which not work, it's empty path, and here a pavage which avoids the point zero. Then you cannot make the involution. You cannot take a piece here and put it in the path. You can do this if the path is empty, if there is a piece containing zero. If not, so what remains is all the pavage not containing zero, which is exactly this. This is the cofactor, you see. So this same kind of involution with different conditions give you exactly the proof. But I will insist because I have proven this in part two with heaps of pieces, etc. But we get a direct proof in part one with rational fraction. There was a direct proof, and the direct proof was the following. If you go back to part one, you have this path. You have a path in the graph in blue. You have this configuration of 2x2 disjoint cycle. And then we look the first time, else we cross the path, go back to the same point, or else the path intersects one of these cycles. So for example, here, the first time it appears, it intersects itself. Then I delete this loop, and then the red loop, I put it with a configuration of cycle. Now, if I go back to the path, it will, first time it will touch a cycle, and then I put back the cycle to the. So doing this Bajiti proof is exactly the same as doing here. I look my path, I look the first time, else I am making a cycle, I intersect myself, or else I am touching one of the 2x2 disjoint cycle here. So you see the unity of all these Bajiti proofs, they are all the same in different languages, different things. So maybe I can prove some extension of this formula, which can be useful. Some extension is so let's take 0 and k, two integers. Instead of taking all the paths bounded between 0 and k, let's take two integers r and s. And I am taking the sum mu n r s k, the sum of all the weighted paths, Motkin paths, of length n. They are bounded by level k, they are starting at level r, and they are ending at level s. So sometimes these kind of paths are considered in some paper in the literature, but let's do what we have done here. There is no problem to extend this to such paths. So there is two cases. I start from r, and r is less than s. R and S are between 0 and k, so I claim that the derivative function of such path is equal to this. Why? It just applies the linear algebra lemma. So you have what is a numerator? So you must take a self-avoiding walk starting from R going to S. So this is this full bar here. This is a self-avoiding walk, and then you have to take for the numerator, some configuration of cycle, 2x2 disjoint, a disjoint from this self-avoiding walk. So if you apply the linear algebra proof, then so you have to take some a pavage here, a 2x2 disjoint cycle, a pavage here, and all these cycles, once one or two, must be disjoint from this. So you get this and this are the two pavages. This pavage here is PR, and this pavage here, always a reciprocal, with shifted by s plus 1. So this will be sum of the weight of such disjoint point species here, here. Denominator is the same, always the same. Denominator. The numerator is not changing, it's a cofactor. It's the sum of the weight of the blue path, the self-avoiding path going from I to j, and you put cycle 2x2 disjoint. So it's very simple on this line to do this. So now, second case, it's not totally symmetric. So second case is because when I go from R to S, then there is a weight. When I go down in this self-avoiding walk, there is this weight appearing. That's the only difference, which in these two formulas, you exchange R and S but there is this weight appearing because it's not totally symmetric. There is a one weight for northeast, and there is a lambda k for southeast. So when I'm going to go down here, I have this path appearing, this weight appearing. And then there is a nice formula for the special case. You get the convergent, S equals zero. And no, this is not. For the you get a special case for the convergent, R equals S equals zero. This is not the picture. No, sorry, this picture goes for the next slide. Forget this picture here. So you get back as a special case the convergent, and you get this special case where you start from level zero and R equals K. So you get this formula, this nice formula. It's start path starting from level zero, bounded by level K, and ending in level K. You get this nice formula. There is only a T power on the numerator. The numerator is numerator is exactly this, you see. This picture, where the bar. So you have completely eliminated this these two segments here, which give you this product of two polynomials. So in the special case, everybody is eliminated on the top, and you get this formula. Even I can make some more complicated formula. Let's take an integer L. Let's take the path going from 0, ending in 0, bounded by level k, and going above the level L. So they must touch the level L plus 1. So I claim that I have this formula. So you see, path touching such path is a difference. This is the path bounded by level k minus the path bounded by level l. So this gives the path which reaches the level l plus 1. And now on the right hand side, there is a unique decomposition of this path. You look the first time, see, you cut in three parts, omega 1, the red part, and omega 2. The first time you reach the level L plus 1. So it is the northeast step from L to L plus 1. So you have the derivative function for omega 1, which is going to be one of this T power something. This is a previous theorem here, when I go from a level 0 to level K. So it's a particular case. So you have T power L divided by this. And then I have a path, I have this step. And then I have a path starting from this level, bounded by k, and ending here, which also is a special case of previous formula, in which give me this. And then there is an extra factor here. And now, if you multiply everybody, take off the denominator, you get this formula. If you multiply this polynomial here, multiply this polynomial here, so you get this nice formula between orthogonal polynomial. And there is a well-known formula for orthogonal polynomial in the case L equals K minus 1, which means that you see it's a path which are really touching. They are bounded by K, but they are touching the level K. So for L plus 1 equals K, L equals K minus 1, then you get a special case of this formula is this one. And this is a well-known well-known formula in the orthogonal polynomial theory. But all the formula I have given, you see, it's there is special case in many, many papers with special polynomial, special Bk-lambda k, but here you see the general proof, in fact, is in the spirit of the proof of the convergent, else bijectively or else by linear algebra, by cofactor, determinant, or anything you want. And the path here, the graph is very simple. It's a line graph, and the cycle are only length 1, length 2, and you get all this formula. So you can ask, but what is the relation between a Stieglitz quantum fraction and a Jacobi quantum fraction? So this is called contraction of continuous fraction. because you are going to contract, you glue the level two by two, you press, you contract the level, but we are going to see that is exactly analog in the, on the path. And there is a very simple proof in term of path. So this is a Stieltjes contour fraction. This is a Jacobi contour fraction. And what is the relation? The question is, here is a Stieltjes contour fraction. Instead of lambda k, I put a sequence gamma with gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma k. And this Stieltjes contour fraction is going to be a Jacobi with b and lambda. What is the relation between how compute, if you know the gamma, how to compute the bk and lambda k? Very simple. Go back to part 1, chapter 2a, slides 55 to 58. You have a bijection between two column Hodgkin path and Dick path. So take a Dick path. And the bijection to show this is Catalan number and two column Hodgkin path of length, this is of length 2n, two column Hodgkin path of length n minus 1 is again the Catalan number. And the bijection was the following. See, you start, you take off the first and last step, you start from the second vertex, and you jump 2 by 2, you jump on the Dick path 2 by 2. So which means that going 2 by 2, you have four kinds of transition. You can go up, up, down, down, or this kind east, north east, or this kind. And so this will be correspond to north step in the Hodgkin path. This will be a south east step in the Hodgkin path. And this, you stay the same level. So which means you will have to choose one of these two. See, this will be a blue level. This one will correspond to a blue level, and this one to a red level. So blue level, red level, and this is a bijection. If you can replace, if you have a Hodgkin two column Hodgkin path of length n minus 1, you just replace this all these possible steps by this. So maybe it may happen that, for example, you see the red step, you are going to replace by something going down below the zero axis. But because we are adding at the beginning, at the end, north-south step, there is no problem. This is really a bijection between Dick path of length 2n and two column Hodgkin path of length n minus 1. But now there is a second, I will need a second bijection also. If instead of starting at this step, if I start from this step, and again I go 2 by 2. So this is not a bijection between Dick path and two column Hodgkin path. It will be a bijection between Dick path and two column Hodgkin path of length n, having no red step at the zero level. But I need these two different contractions of path. I am going to do the same with the weight. And then playing with these two different contractions and with a weighted path, next chapter, I will give a proof of the so-called famous QD algorithm, quotient difference algorithm, which gives you an algorithm to compute, to expand in contour fraction power theory. This algorithm can be explained by a combination of these two contractions. So the first contraction is a So I do the same, you see. I do the second contraction. And you see, you can put the weight now. This is, so there is the gamma underlying is the weight of the Dick path coming from the Stieltjes contour fraction. And now I have the blue, I have the lambda k bk, which is going to be give me the bk lambda k of the contour fraction. And you see here the lambda 1, the product, the lambda k will be a product of two gamma. And the blue step will be correspond to this, etc. So you will have this condition, you see. If you have a east step, it can be blue or red. The bk, which is there is only one kind of east step. The bk can be coming from this or coming from this. So the weight of the bk will be the sum of these two weights, gamma 2k and gamma 2k plus 1. And the lambda k, the weight of this, will be the product of these two weights here. So just by looking at the contraction of path, you will get this formula, this correspondence, that if you have a Stieltjes contour fraction with a gamma k, then you get the Jacobi contour fraction with bk equals this, and lambda k equals this. See, the sum of the weight of dig pass by gamma will be the same as the sum of the weight of Motkin pass with this new weight bk lambda k because of this picture. When you start 2 by 2, then you will get exactly this correspondence. There is a bijection between the Motkin pass and the dig pass. When I put weight, I don't need to make a distinction. I don't need to make a distinction between the E-step going from this and the E-step going from this. I don't need to put blue and red color on the E-step. I will put a single E-step, will be the sum, will be come from this plus this. It's clear that there is a geometric contraction just in terms of path, and the weight can go through the contraction and give you this formula. But it will be useful to do the second contraction. When I was starting, it was really a bijection between dig path of length 2 and Motkin path of n minus 1, 2-column Motkin path, when I start from this. So I have again some formula, which is going to be different. Now I put this bk plus and lambda k plus. So the formula will be different. The correspondence between the second gamma k and the second bk lambda k of Jacobi coefficient will be different, and this will give you this formula. This will be the Stieltjes coefficient will be equal to 1 plus gamma 1t multiplied by this. Because this is removing the first and last step, this corresponds. So there is a shift by 1. It's the same as dig path of length 2n, Motkin path of length n minus 1. A shift by 1, taking off the last step. And I have this now new weight. It's not the same as before. And this formula will be very useful in the next chapter by playing with the two formulas. And I will finish this memorial lecture dedicated to Philippe Flageolet with some examples, and especially some examples you love about elliptic function. So we have seen in different chapters of this class, especially in part one, we have seen the expansion of tangent g in second number. This is a tangent number. This is a second number. This was done by Euler again. All this generating function. But the interpretation in terms of permutation was made by Désiré André 100 years later. And the bijective theory was done by Fratat-Sternberger again 1 century later. Each time there is 100 years between Euler, André, and Fratat-Sternberger. So this is called the Sekret number, sometimes called Euler number. So this is a number of alternating permutation on an even number, and this is tangent number is a number of alternating permutation on an odd number. Alternating permutation in terms of Laguerre-Historé means there is no double rise, no double descent for an odd number. Sekret number means there is a single double with the convention at the beginning, a single double descent at the beginning. So this is the interpretation of this coefficient, an exponential geometric function, alternating permutation. And Désiré André, 1880. So this is a permutation, and alternating means it goes down, up, down, up, down, up. There is no double rise, no double descent. And there is a geometric study by Fratat-Sternberger, which is a geometric theory of Eulerian polynomial, but also there is a second number, tangent number in this study. And see, second number, this is again Euler, 1561, it's odd. Odd number for the second number. This is the second, and he writes this like this, and he compute. You see, he go very far computing the second number. He has tangent t also, so this is maybe more complicated to understand because there is a Bernoulli numbers inside. The B is the Bernoulli numbers. Bernoulli was one of the advisors. There is brother Bernoulli. There's many Bernoulli. He went to Saint Petersburg with Daniel Bernoulli, the son of. One of the, there were two Bernoulli, Jean Bernoulli, Jacques Bernoulli. They hate each other. There were a big problem. But he get private lesson from Jean Bernoulli, and then he was sent to Saint Petersburg when he was 20. he went to because Benny had said, okay, to the Pierre Le Grand asked to they to come, but no, I want my son to go with the both of them. You take zero or two of them together. So they go together, and when they arrive in St. Petersburg, Pierre Le Grand died just, and so there was some problem with them. But they stayed there for with Catherine, Imperatrice of Russia. Okay, let's. So if you apply the Laguerre history, the Bickel of Decay, to get alternating permutation. You know, there is a bisection between permutation and weighted path. This is the moment. Go back to the moment. And the, so if there is no double rise, no double descent, the BK are zero, and lambda K is KK plus one. If you look carefully at the bisection, just apply this. So it's writing in a different language. The moment of the tangent number was given by BK by some history with lambda K. In fact, there was a lambda k was a product of ak minus 1 ck, and ck was k plus 1, ak minus 1 was k, etc. So you remember. So this is the product ak minus 1 multiplied by ck, which is lambda k. So we have done this in the moment of a special case of the orthogonal Schaeffer polynomial. And now you get a derivative function, but ordinary derivative function. So always, it is a Laplace transform. You have to take the tangent t, and this is the Laplace transform. We change the transform in analysis, which go from an exponential derivative function, which give it the ordinary derivative function. Or you have also the second number. It's, you replace kk plus 1 by k to the square. So in the earlier paper, we have seen the relation with Bernoulli numbers. So Bernoulli numbers are rational numbers. And there is some integer very close to Bernoulli. The closer integer are this integer, the Jenoki numbers. If you multiply the Bernoulli by 2 power 2 power 2n minus 1, you get some integer, which are the famous Jenoki numbers. And there is a nice relation between the Jenoki and the tangent number. 1 times tangent number equals 2 power 2n Jenoki. We have many interpretations of Jenoki numbers. There is alternating pistol, there is Dumont permutation, there is many different interpretations. There is many interpretations of tangent number. And if you multiply all the interpretations, we'll show you that this number is divisible by 2 power n. But to show that it's divisible by 2 power 2n and the result is a Jenoki, this is an open problem. To find a bijection. Han and a student of Han, you know Han in Strasbourg, they begin to have a Coital proof, but not a direct bijection, not a bijection which clearly shows that this is divisible by 2 power 2n. And Jenoki appear. So Jenoki numbers are always odd number, 1, 1, 3, 17, 155, and it was called because of Jenoki at the end of the 19th century. But if you go back to again to earlier, you get you get 1, 3, 17, 155. You get the Jenoki numbers also in Euler, and this relation is so there's still open problem around this Jenoki. And you see here, my good master is showing tangent t over 2. This is related again to the divisibility, the Jenoki number. This is another interpretation of, and he's doing non-commutative differential equation. All this is related to the theory of differential equation. And, but go back to Jenoki numbers, there is again an expansion in continuous fraction. And this is possible with what we know in combinatorics. We can prove easily this expansion. So instead of, you see, the second number, it was, or tangent number, it was kk plus 1 or k to the square. Now it's half. It's a product of these two. If you have only one of this number, you get n factorial. You get the Euler continuous fraction. But it's a product now. And to prove this, you go back to Laguerre history for alternating the Laguerre history, and you can show that there is a bijection between some objects. In fact, these objects are called alternative pistol. This was a paper where I have done with Dominique Dumont. And this alternative pistol give you interpretation because of the Seidel interpretation of Jenoki, give you interpretation. Then you get some bijection. You can get some, you have to work to go from this pistol to alternating permutation. And then your Jenoki number, this kind of object, will be exactly in bijection with alternating permutation. such that the associated Laguerre history is such that the choice PI is odd. You always take odd choice, so this explains the divisibility by 2 here. So we can do it with the classical objects which are in the nature about pistol and Genoki numbers and all this. And I will finish now with some complement. So if you don't understand, just to honor Philippe Lagelet, who like very much this elliptic function and some other function. So I will finish quickly. It's a complement just to give you an idea of the. So the tangent second number function can be extended to Jacobi elliptic function. You have the function Sn, Cn, Dn. It's exactly the same as second and tangent, but you have a parameter inside, parameter k, that satisfies some differential equation. And there is many. There's 3 different computer interpretations with 3 different ways to interpret this. So we see there is a parameter here, K2. And for example, one of these interpretations gives you the Laplace transform of the elliptic function Cn. So we see it's the same as second, but one level of it. So if you don't have, if you put alpha equal 1, you get second. And here the parameter is one, every even level, you get the. So this is kind of elliptic function. And I will go to this very beautiful paper of Philippe Lagelet, the Fermat cubic elliptic function, continuous fraction, and a quartile excursion. This is a beautiful paper he has given in 2005 at the Seminaire Lotharingien 54. And you see, he starts the paper with this Apéry continuous fraction, and it's a very beautiful paper. It was a beautiful gift from my. This was my 60th birthday. It was a very beautiful gift by Flagellet. He was combining all quantum fraction, ordinary polynomial, some number theory, and also he was working with differential equation. We have seen very briefly in part one, I have made a very short excursion to the combinatorial theory of a differential equation. And here he has some beautiful differential equation. We start from this in the paper, and then he defines this function, some other elliptic function, the same Dicksonian elliptic function. Again, there is some differential equation. Here is a Fermat cubic curve, x to the 3 plus y to the 3 equal 1. And then you look at the paper of Conran when there is this beautiful expansion of the Laplace transform of this elliptic function. See, with very complicated lambda k, etc. This is related to the Apéry fraction. And then to show this, he used it's the analog of the quantum theory of differential equation. He looks at the Polya-Urn model, and he makes some history. You have an urn with ball, and you take a white ball, and you can replace the white ball by 2 black. You take a black ball, and you replace it by 2. And it's totally other. See, so this is a blue and red. You take a blue ball, and you replace by 2 red. Then you take this one, and you replace it by, remove, replace by 2 blue. Then you take, etc. Then you take this x here, replace it by 2y. So you have some kind of history. This is an history analog to the history we have done. So there's a connection between history we have done, the Polya-Urn history, and also the differential equation, the combinatorial theory of differential equation. And then if you total number of history, you start from a black ball and you finish with completely white, then the number of history is n factorial. Then it's related to this function SM. So it's beautiful combinatorics. And then he can give interpretation of the expansion of this function in terms of this history. And then it's related to the paper I have said before by Dumont, Flagellet, Schott, etc., etc. And then they have an interpretation with, again, with some permutation, 2 repeated, 3 repeated, because the interpretation were for alternating permutation. They don't fit for the continuous fraction. For the quantum fraction, you need another interpretation. And then it's difficult to relate the 2 interpretations. And you have beautiful, some of his last paper was with Bachet in Grenoble, and he has this beautiful expansion for the pseudo-factorial function. You see, again, with the many product. And also, it's related to the Weierstrass function, latit sum, all this. He has some. So this was the last postcard he put in 2010. This is a summation on the square lattice, a big summation, and you get this continuous fraction. expansion. So this is very deep kind of mixture of a continuous fraction and combinatorics. Unfortunately, he died 2011. We don't have a postcard, but also I will finish my talk by saying that Flageolet, he loved to learn Sanskrit, and he was very interested in Sanskrit language, and he put with his Gérard Huet, his colleague in INRIA, he make a dictionary, a beautiful dictionary, French to Sanskrit, and so I have a picture. So go back to I have a picture in Sanskrit here. See, so this is, I will finish my talk with the Sanskrit. This is a famous text in Sanskrit. Okay, so thank you very much for your patience.